Game number one in the final at the Enter the Storm North America. The second qualifier, and we have VOX Nihili going up against the Murlocs, the Murloc Geniuses. To the left side of the map, we have Srey on Leoric, we have Hosti on Abatha, Goat on Sylvanas, and again they play Zeratul, this time played by Goku, as the Rixi is jumping on Tacita for the additional heals. And to the right side of our first map, Tomb of the Spider Queen, we are seeing the Murloc Geniuses with Equinox on Kerrigan. We have Cawthon Luck on Sonya, Faye on Taranda, we have Fury on ETC, and Mad Timmy on Malfurion. Pretty nice setups here. I especially like that we are having a very European setup here with the Taranda, Sonya, and even ETC. A bit of a focus on Kerrigan now too, so it looks like they really want to go heavy on the aggression and even like melee assassin style. Sonya might be classified as a warrior, but right now she's more played as a melee assassin than anything else. Oh, already they hit against Abatha with the owl here. Nice aim. And we see Hosti going straight into the Locust Talent on level 1. So he's going to be trying to be all over the map and pushing lanes, which is not easy as an Abatha on this map in particular. The big problem that you oftentimes have is that it's a rather small map, so you can easily just try and hunt Abatha down. Of course, it changes a bit when the first forts are down, but it's going to make easier just a little bit. And we have Goku and... oh, the stun comb against Leoric! He Wraith walks away, but he is a bit too late. So yep, Goku is already down, but he... Srey is down, but he will be back in just a second. Goku was the one just like watching at the sidelines, not really interacting in any way. But right now we have up to the top lane, just like the split. Cawthon Luck is going to have probably an easy time pushing this back. I mean, he is going to take some damage, but then again, he also has the Whirlwind, which gives him the sustain. You can already tell that laning against Sonya right now is not really the easiest thing. She's very, very strong these days. But that Sylvanas play that we've seen from Team VOX Nihili already a lot is coming again into play here at the bottom lane. Equinox, Fane, Fury are starting to rotate, and this is one of the things that they will probably do throughout the early game. Try to like hit the bottom lane and the top lane whenever there's an opportunity to drop a target. So a lot of pressure here already on VOX Nihili. Srey has felt first hand that he can't just simply stay there and rely on his Wraith Walk. It's going to be incredibly difficult to just like stay alive here. Rixi up at the top lane though with the Tacita and the shield shouldn't really have the most trouble staying alive. But down here it is Tacita who's being attacked. Abatha helps out, the stun hits, the owl doesn't, and Goku survives for now. But it's really the plays on the side of the Murlocs that are making the pace of the game. We have level 3 versus level 3. We're seeing on the side of Sonya, by the way, Block being used as a level 1 talent. It's an interesting choice. Normally you see either Warpaint for extra sustain during the fights. You can easily get these auto attacks in between your slams if you really want to. Or you just see most of the players going for the Shot of Fury, which helps you even a bit more. But at this point, it's Block and therefore sustain that she chooses. We have Goat going up against Mad Timmy. The Malfurion player here will have a tough time pushing Sylvanas back. Sylvanas, especially after level 7, is going to be incredibly strong with that lane push, thanks to the unstable poison. We're seeing for Zeratul, Vampiric Strike, and we also have the Leeching Plasma. Keep in mind that Tacita is currently the only support for the team. Well, maybe not the only one. You have also Abatha, of course, which helps to a certain extent with the shields and with potential spike talents later, even though it's much more likely at this point that we're going to see Locust talents taken on 13 and 16. But still, Tacita will be the main source of sustain. And therefore, Leeching Plasma has been taken. Oh my god, Cawthon Luck barely escapes. But in the mid lane, it is Srey dying again on his Leoric. 2 kills against him already. And the rotation to the top lane. It's incredibly difficult to stay alive against the setup. With the Sonya, with the Taranda, and also, of course, that Kerrigan jumping in for the stuns, you have a tough time just like staying out of these stunlocks. Ah, this is exactly what we've been talking about. Boom! There is the next kill. Tacita is dead. That's 3 kills against 0, and it just shows once again the power of stacking stuns, especially, of course, with the Kerrigan and also that Sonya in. Let's not forget about Taranda, which adds the extra damage. So very, very powerful opening here for the Murlocs. But besides all of these kills, I mean, all of these kills disregarded for a second, if you only look at the experience, it's nearly the same experience level. Srey is moving away, dies again. That's the third time now that he has fallen. Goat collects most of the gems and then moves away. Srey is going to be back in a sec, but still, it is a slight lead that we're seeing for the Murlocs. They have, overall though, not really as much of a lead as you would think with this many kills. But Sylvanas is now dying at the bot lane to Cawthon Luck, and he is currently being attacked by Zeratul, but this is kill number 5 already, and this is really getting out of hand now. The Murloc Geniuses are playing an incredible early game here. Searing Arrows on Faye are giving her even more damage. it's really damage-oriented build without going into Season Marksman. Still going for that Ranger's Mark talent, which reduces the cooldown on her trade. And Rixie is again being jumped. Oh, yep, and he is also getting killed. 6 kills against 0. Wow. That is a bit crazy. We have currently Zeratul already rotating down into the mid lane. And Corfin Luck is staying at the bot lane, just like holding the experience for his team. They are level ahead, looking really, really strong there. Matt Timmy is, of course, healing everyone now, and he is going full heal. I mean, look at that build on Malfurion right now. He went into Harmony on level 1, straight into the Rampant Growth and Enduring Growth here. I mean, you can't go for more heal talents than that. Goku still takes him out at the bot lane, so he was about to escape here. But Goku eliminates him as the Web Weavers are now being pushed towards the left. Good turn in here on the side of the Murloc Geniuses, but they should probably wait for Malfurion to come back. They can execute some pressure here. They can actually burst Sylvanas down if she's staying like this. Oh, the stun was perfect! Faye with such a good move here. Really well done. She waited for the wave, did not try to stun before that. Waits for the wave. Sylvanas jumps in. The stun hits home. They can't get the kill, but still, that put a lot of pressure onto Goat. Of course, on level 7, we're now seeing Kala's Embrace taken. We have a few Toxic Nest talents on Abatha. Down to the bot lane. Corfin Luck still with the damage here, moves in. He has 39 gems, by the way. Needs to be really careful that he doesn't die. And over here, looking into the mid lane, the Web Weavers are still pushing. Malfurion, oh, the kill again against Tessa. This is a slaughter. I mean, this is really cool what we're seeing on the side of the Murlocs. They get another kill, maybe. Thray is solo and gets away, and so does Goat. But oh my god, are these guys getting taken apart now? We are still in the early game, of course, pre-level 10, pre-heroic abilities, but the early game definitely in the hands of Team Murloc Geniuses. And on this map in particular, you can really start to snowball a match if you hit that level 10 early and you get the second Web Weaver wave to turn in. That's, of course, what they're aiming for right now. Omega Storm, Tranquility. I mean, this Malfurion build is just killing me. This guy is going for every single heal ability that he has. We're gonna see, of course, on level 13 and also Lifesea taken. Think about the numbers that this guy can push out. There's no Elude's Grace for him. He doesn't care about that. He doesn't go for the Moonfire spam on level 1 with the Moonburn or anything. No, it's just like full heals, and they go for boss already. Rixie is looking at this with the Storm. He revealed what's happening, and now the rotation to the top has started. It's an aggressive move. It's a risky move, but if they get the boss, that would be great for them. And now the rest of the team rotates, of course, again. The Blue Web Weavers are released, and everybody is just focusing on the boss. Tassadar is down. Here come the heroics into play, and this is going to be a boss that will be claimed by the Murloc Geniuses. You can't move in against that, even if they hit the heroics in time. A 4 versus 5 at this point of the game would be suicidal. There they are, the heroics, the Web Weavers are there too, but the boss is going to help with the deep push for now. Level 11 versus level 10. They're seeing two battle momentums, by the way, on the side of Tyrande for extra stuns and extra owls. And we have Kerrigan with the battle momentum to try and get a few more stun comps out. Really solid setup. March of the Black King has been taken. The Ultimate Evolution is another talent that we're seeing on Abatha. Wailing Arrow also. And now to the bot lane, at least the pressure through the wall, taking both of these towers. In experience, this was a great move that we're seeing on the side of Team VOX Nihili. They took one of their forts and they pushed some of the towers back. Of course, the top lane is a bit of a problem, but they closed the gap of experience just slightly. It's more or less a trade in structures, though, since this boss is doing some solid damage. But they're not looking too bad yet. They're roughly a level behind. I mean, that's not really something to be proud of. You're not gonna write a letter back home to mama and saying, like, dear mom, today we were only level behind. But it is going to put you in a spot where you can still catch up. So, with 8 kills against 1, if you look at the experience difference, it's not as much as a lot of people might suspect. And Goat is part of this, because he moves in against all these towers over and over again and pushes them down. And that's something that gives them a lot of EXP, of course. Already the turn-in attempt on the side of the red team, and the Murloc Geniuses, they get the next Web Weaver wave. Rixie dodges the stun comp, Equinox not getting the Primal Grasp in. And there, Sylvanas is still up at the top lane, pretty safe. Hosti actually starting to rotate around two. He's escaping just in the last second. And Goat is also on the way back. Level 13s are gonna hit soon, and the Murloc geniuses are still slightly ahead, and they're doing well here. Oh, Kerrigan down, what a great Void Prism, isolating Malfurion, no heals for Kerrigan, and Malfurion himself is now attacked. In comes the ETC, saving him with a mosh pit. It's a party. Nice moves here on the side of Leoric. He is the hottest guy in the dance floor, not really hot, no Tyrael in. But still, there's another great power slide and these stuns. Wraithwalk used, but even Coffin Luck with all that burst damage on Sonya is not able to take Leoric down in time. We have still Webweavers pushing the lanes. Level 13 versus level 13 soon enough. Already Coffin Luck, Faye in position at the bot lane, pushing in the towers. 13 hits, and now we have Eviscerate taken for the extra range on the Ravage. We are seeing also the Mystical Sphere, and that's going to help Coffin Luck to be even more mobile on the map. And the Ice Block for Malfurion, who decided that it's still a bad idea to go into the Life Seed, which he would probably have preferred. Kill against Leoric again. Leorki is down once more. Goku is being forced back now. Level 13 talents for both of the teams. And he's going into the Assassin Blades. There's no wormhole for him. Assassin Blade, it is a Tacita! Oh my god, that prescience just barely saved him here. Taranda is dead, and that was at least a trade, a one-for-one. Goku is going in again. Goku wants to kill. Zeratul is on the way, but Coffin Luck escapes. Kerrigan, on the other hand, she might not be so lucky. Kerrigan and Fury, they are both in trouble. ETC, it's a triple kill already, and this might become a quad kill. Goku should be able to move in. There is no fort. No fault to keep him alive. And Tacita is, or Zeratul is actually a bit too late here. Here comes the wave and the shots. Goku is not even needed. They take down ETC. And this is why VOX Nihili is so dangerous. They get 5 kills in this. They nearly wiped the entire team. The only hero that survived was Sonya. And they are a level ahead now. They are level ahead. They got slaughtered in the early game, but once the heroic abilities dropped for them, they were able to make a comeback here. Great players on the side of the blue team, and they have even a Webweaver wave coming in now. They don't have access to the level 16 talent just yet, but they are in a position where they can start to take down a few more structures and get closer and closer to that extra talent. Great moves by them on the map here. And now that the early game has passed, it's a lot more difficult for the Murloc geniuses to really just execute that power of their composition. Like, this fort has fallen before the Webweaver is even there. That means the focus of the blue team is now all up to the top lane, where Hosty was of course pressuring already earlier, and that fort is at half HP. They're jumping in, and this is looking like they could get even more. And wow, look at the bot lane. Goku and Hosty are starting to push the bot lane here. Slabatha is going into slapping range. Well, we have the top lane also attacked now, but of course you have to rotate against the bot lane if you want to make sure that you are not losing a keep. And at this point, they can't afford to. The 16 talents are ready, and that means we have Locust Brood. That also means that, oh, ETC with another mosh pit at the top. But yeah, it's a very solo dance here, alone on the dance floor. Goat moving away. Stuns are not hitting, and Sray is also moving out of this without losing anything. Hosty has the copy on Zeratul. They are all starting to move in for this one, and it means that the Webweaver at the bot lane has still a lot of time and space to drop this keep, and he might not get it, but it's going to be damn close. At the top lane, we are seeing the fort about to be eliminated, and this is just incredible. They were so far behind. This setup that we're seeing for the Murloc Genius is such an aggressive setup in the early game, but now in the mid game, they are really having their work cut out for them, because Team VOX Nihili, with their heroic abilities, they have definitely found their rhythm. And of course, Abathur himself is now also much, much stronger on the map right now. They're playing a great game here. Kerrigan here, Equinox, he needs to be careful. He's all alone. What a force wall. Rixie in the early game had a couple of bad moments here, but he's making up for all of those in the last few fights. The force wall here absolutely spot on, cutting Kerrigan off from the rest of the team, and they get another kill. They are 2 levels ahead right now. They lost the boss earlier, and at this point it doesn't even matter anymore. They burst down the waves, they have 58 gems. They can get an easy turn in again if they just pick up one more wave, and it looks like the Murloc geniuses are actually thinking about contesting the boss here. That would be an interesting move, considering that they are down one talent, but nope, they're not moving in, they're not risking it. Abathur is at the bot lane, he's creating so much space for the team now. He has 11 gems, by the way, and in total they are now at 58, so once again, only 2 more of those gems. That's all that you need, and now they can turn them in if they want to. But down here, it's again the keep that has, by the way, been destroyed by the Webweaver earlier. Keep is down. They're starting to move in now against the mid lane, most likely, since the boss is going to free push the top lane. They're just controlling every single aspect of this game. There's the mid lane approach as already expected. At the top lane, the boss is being defended against by Khaldor and Faye. The mid lane with even the Bruiser camp that they just picked. Now they can go in, the Bruiser camp is going to do so much damage. Sylvanas, it's one of the key heroes for them every time. And they're showing again why. The keep is down to half health, level 16 versus 16. We have the Echo Paddle, ETC with a great ult. They get a kill, they get the double kill, and that might be exactly what they needed. Goku, he still wants the keep, he uses the Void Prism. The keep is gonna fall, it should. And yes, it does. Or does it? Yeah, the last second, the Bruisers take it down. They lost two heroes, but they got the keep, and that is two keeps that they were able to take down. Really well played. That mosh pit, on the other hand, really doing the damage, and they get a double kill out of this one. 11 kills against 7, but they are 2 levels behind right now. When it really comes to the kills, then yeah, Murloc geniuses are doing a great job, but it's really just like the movements on the map and also the structures that have been taken out that give that massive lead now to VOX Nihili. This is the first map, of course, of the final, so we're going to see at least one more after this one, but it already showcases the strength that we're seeing on VOX Nihili. And also, that they don't panic too much, like they don't fall apart when they are behind a bit. They actually play this cool, calm and collected, and they nearly lose Tazadai again at the top, but Prescience is saving his butt. So, we have another fort eliminated, a camp taken. The lanes, of course, are heavily pushed right now, and that's especially true when we're talking about, like, the catapults now also starting to move in. Over here, the turn-in attempts are happening. Keep in mind that there were a few gems lost by the blue team when they lost their heroes. Again, Wraithwalk being used, and even a force wall. I mean, it's still dangerous, let's be honest here. If you run into the red team and they start their stun chain, then you are in trouble. I love, by the way, how Goku is playing that backdoor style with Hosty. Now they're running in with a copy and Zeratul. And I think that he might have wanted to stay there. They could have gotten that keep, actually. They still can take it, and they will. He takes the keep down, and it's just that dirty, dirty backdoor attempt. All of the keeps are gone, and level 20 talents have been reached with the Nexus Blade. We're also seeing a Hardened Shield and the Storm Shield. And here comes the attack that we've been waiting for. Using the Storm Shield, they want to go in. Goku is waiting for his Rogue ability for a good Void Prism to be dropped. And this is smelling trouble already. There's the Void Prism! Leoric is still dead though. And the Void Prism is just going to delay this. The Void Prism is going to delay it, but they are still moving in. And the Murloc geniuses are not defeated yet. Yes, they lost every single key, but they are not down yet. They are still fighting. And they are getting the first key. They're taking one. They get the keep, and don't forget about these Web Weavers. They are still in play. How deep are they going to go with this? It looks like they're trying to move to the top. They're still lingering around. Leoric is going to be back in another 10. He's going to be back very soon, cheating death as we speak. And it's the half a level that Murloc geniuses need to get that 20. Over here, Leoric, what is straining? He's so far out, but there comes the silence. Hosty jumps in with a copy on Zeratul. He's bursted down immediately, though. Leoric again on the way back, but Sray is dying once more. Oh my god. He died 7 times already in this game. 7 times. I mean, he's the solo tank for his team, but the Murloc geniuses, they are still doing this. Guys, they just killed a keep and they eliminated the fort of the bot lane. They are level 20 now. This game is not necessarily over. It's the massive lead, of course, for VOX Nihili. I mean, nobody is doubting that. But there's so many gems that VOX Nihili just lost. They had a turn-in. They could have gone for the turn-in. They decided against it. And we have right now, well, once again, another camp taken, and they're starting to push the bot lane. All these stuns are starting to hurt. The Hunter's Swiftness, has been taken. And we have also Bolt of the Storm for Kerrigan. We have the Hardened Shield for Sonya. And a Storm Shield plus the Tour Bus. Tour Bus is being used as well. Keep in mind, though, that in the last game, we actually saw Goku move in towards the core and a copy on Zeratul together with a few catapults trying to eliminate the core. And it worked really well. If you don't have the awareness for that, you might lose the game to a move like this. So Goku has a chance to do that again in this game if one of these lanes pushes, and the top lane does exactly that right now. The tower is going to fall, the catapults are going to take care of it. Of course, this is going to be deep pushed, but it's still going to be a threat. Turn-ins are happening, both of the teams are aiming for the gems now. There's a lot of gems for VOX Nihili. They have a lot of those. They actually have nearly a turn-in ready. And here comes Hosty. The Slugger moves now into the map as well. And this is like saying, alright, let's get rid of these and then I can back up again. Boss taken at the top. That's a big, big problem. But this is the moment that they could use to try that backdoor. And look where Zeratul is going. You know this guy? Hell yeah. And he's moving in, and guess who else is there? There is the GOAT, aka Sylvanas, up at the top lane. Oh, Tassadar is stopping the Kerrigan TP! Tassadar is stopping the TPs! He's stopping all of the TPs! They're going for the core! VOX Nihili! Look at the Void Prism! God, these guys are douchebags! I love it! They are awesome! This is great! This is so mean! They go for the core, Sylvanas is down, and they're gonna get it! That D-back move, it's brilliant. Oh god, I love these guys. They are amazing. 1-0 lead for VOX Nihili here at the end of the Storm final against the Murloc Geniuses. The game is live. We are on map number 2, ladies and gentlemen, here at the end of the Storm Finals. VOX Nihili is playing against the Murloc Geniuses. And, well, they are also in the lead now. They won the last map on Tomb of the Spider Queen with a bit of a backdoor move there, thanks to Abathur and Zeratul. For now, we have Thray to the left side of the map. We're playing Janna for VOX Nihili. They're seeing Hosty on Zagara. And they play again with Sylvanas, this time played by Goat. Goku is on Vala and Rixie on Malfurion. A solid setup for them, heavily orientated towards push. It was also Johanna, of course, with that lane clear. And to the right side of the map, it's Equinox on Kerrigan for the Murloc Geniuses. Faye again on Tyrande. We have Matt, Timmy on Tassadar. Fury on Mirrodin. And we see Korth and Luck against on Sonya. And this is a lot of stun and burst power. And we all know how that last game went. The early game, Murlocs destroyed. And they start again with an early kill. But then later on in the game, it was still the team of VOX Nihili that was able to claim victory. So for now, we have on Kerrigan no Ravage talents. Instead, it's actually the Sharpened Blades for the increased damage on her. So they rely heavily on... Well, I guess at this point right now, they really rely on their stun chains. And while talking stun chains, guess what had just happened? Malfurion is just melting away. He's getting hit by the first stun, and he's just like standing there, and he's like, blah, and dies. Hosty is trying to set up all of those tumors up at the top lane, and they're already moving in with Sylvanas. So the Zagara's and Sylvanas combo is, of course, what you try to use just like burst these lanes down. This is what you usually aim for if you're trying to play a setup that just pushes lanes in, drops structures, and gets ahead like that. That's also what they're going to try and do in this game, but it's really still that threat of being locked down, as we just saw with Malfurion happening a little bit earlier. If that happens, then you are in a really tricky spot, and this is of course something that they somehow need to prevent, and it's not going to be easy. On level 7, we could see a cleanse on Malfurion, and it would probably be a good choice considering how many stuns are stacked there. It would be an excellent choice in my opinion. Well, the first Dragonite is also now appearing on the map. Again, Thray is attacked over here, tries to dodge as much as he can, like the jukes everywhere, left to the right to the left. Also, the roots used by Malfurion to help him out a bit with that, but this is just incredible. And here comes the potential kill against Kerrigan. She gets rooted and is taken down. Goku dies too, though. Vala dead, and the attempt to now drop also Faye or Fury. Nope, not gonna happen. Both of the shrines are under the control of the red team, and they have an earlier level 4, with Kerrigan going into Envenom. This is a very different build from what we usually see. Normally it's that focus early on Ravage that we see for most heroes, but she's already adapting. Searing Arrows are helping Tyrande to dish out also quite a fair amount of damage, and Zagara should be able to claim that in time. Yeah, no Dragonite for Faye. She was attempting to use that. Equinox actually misses his stun comp here. Good dodge on the side of the blue team, and Thray at the front line in the tank position is trying to take down Equinox. Good route for Malfurion, and the kill, no, yes, maybe, oh, they get the kill against Vala, but Kerrigan dies too. It's a 1-for-1, oh my god, I love these guys, they are doing an amazing job here, super entertaining match, great jump by Fury, dodging the Condemn, Blizzard is cutting him off, Thray gets stunned and taken out, and Malfurion is also blown to pieces. 6 kills against 2, and then Dragonite up for grabs, and this time Faye is gonna get him. That's the first Dragonite in the game, and the Murloc Geniuses, they are angry. They're really angry, aren't they? I mean, they currently show what they can do here, and it is just absolutely brutal. They do a great job. I'm really loving the way that they're currently playing this. So yeah, at this point it looks very, very solid. The Dragon Knight in the mid lane right now, and having him starting to move in here and do his work. Both of the towers are already down. That's extra experience. Down to the bot lane, Goku and Matt Timmy are fighting, but Faye could actually try and kick Goku over the wall. Yeah, he's missing that a bit. It would have been a bit difficult to pull off either way. Level 7 talents are hitting very, very early here now for the Murloc Geniuses. And the Sonya kill at the top lane. Oh, there could be more than a Sonya kill. Equinox and Fury are also in a bit of trouble. Malfurion is actually starting to become the hunted here. But they turn around and they nearly take down Muradin. But both of the heroes escape. At least it looks like Equinox is going to get away here. Yes, and indeed he does. But Faye was doing a bit more damage at the bot lane, taking down one of the towers here. We have both of the teams now in level 7, and next to the Carla's Embrace for Tacita, who's going to start preloading the shields on all of the heroes. We're having a double battle momentum. Again, battle momentum here for Faye on Taranda for the extra stuns and owls. The Ferocious Healing is going to keep Sonya alive a bit longer. And as already predicted, Cleanse taken as a level 7 Talon of Malfurion. And he kind of needs to get that. I mean, let's be honest here, with all these stuns on the map, you want to have that Cleanse ready. Zagara and also Johanna went straight into their, well, battle momentum to get a few more condemns out to make sure that they can also, like, get more damage thanks to Zagara. And Zagara is currently trying to take this camp, but they already know what's going on. Equinox jumps in. Not sure if that was the smartest move. We'll see in a second. A fight for the camp now. Here comes Horstie. All that damage against Kerrigan! Vala! But the kill against Malfurion and Johanna. Vala is just a bit too late to really have an impact on the fight, so it was a 4 versus 5 for most of the time. 8 kills against 3. There's just like lane pressure everywhere. This is completely different. Well, actually, it's not. It's exactly the same what we've seen in the last game. But I feel like the potential for a comeback for Team VOX Nihili is a little bit smaller than what we had in the games before. But, well, they have to show that they can push that in with their Zagara and Sylvanas comp. For now, though, they are losing heroes left, right, bottom, and center. 8 kills against 3 and level 10s now in play, and that means that we have now Maelstrom, we have Shadowstalk. Here comes Sonya moving in with the Wrath of the Berserker that she, of course, has taken once again. Avatar and the Force Wall. Srey is getting stunlocked again and dies. They melt him away. For him, it's really difficult. If you play Johanna against such a setup, the only thing that you can really do is try to be as... Well, as... You have to really delay your Iron Skin for as long as you can. And you need to use that as soon as one of these stuns starts hitting. The problem really is that if you use Iron Skin a bit too early, as long as it's in cooldown, the next stun combo is going to hit you. So when Iron Skin is in cooldown, you need to play a bit more passive than Srey is currently doing. I think it's a big problem for him that he's the solo tank of the team, since all of the hate is, of course, like, focused on him if he positions himself in front of the rest of the team. And that's exactly what he does. We have level 10 now for both of them, though, and this is when we saw the comeback happening for VOX Nihili in the last game, and they're trying to do that again, but it's the kill, potential kill, against Sylvanas. Kerrigan falls now too. But Zagara is also dead. 11 kills against 4, they move in again. The Maw was alright, but did not really prevent Zagara from going down here. Koth and Luck can just do with Sonya whatever he wants right now. He's getting shielded by Tacita, and that's Faye for the heals. Faye again on the Dragon Knight, and that's the second Dragon Knight of the game. The Murlocs, they are on a rampage right now. They wanna get kills, and they smell blood in the water, and they move in for another potential kill against Goku. And he's down. Well, Srey is also getting attacked now, and the rest of the team is moving into assist him, but it's still a 4 versus 5 position with a Dragon Knight against you. This is not looking pretty at all. This is going to be the first port in the game that falls, and Kerrigan is also back to business, right? Fury has taken quite a bit of damage here, but again, Matt Timmy with the shields everywhere, pre-loading those as much as he can. Here comes the potential kill against Fury, but he moves back just in time. They took down all of the structures. He's already activated his trait, so he will heal up within seconds. We have everybody else here in position now. Faye and Equinox are starting to move in up at the top right now. At the bot lane. At the top lane we have Sonya. And level 13 talents have just now hit. With the overflowing light, first Ravage talent with the Eviscerate, We're seeing also, of course, at this point, the Prescience taken, there's Thunderstrike and Mystical Spear. It's the talents that you would expect. Like, the only deviations that we really have on Kerrigan, for example, are happening on level 1 and level 4. It's a bit more old-school style, what you see here, especially with the Envenom on level 4. Normally, it's still the Ravage talents that are taken here in most of the cases. Actually, we saw also, like, Equinox going for the Ravage talents in the last game, but that Eviscerate still allows him to jump a huge distance. And that just caters towards the aggression that they've been showcasing throughout the game and throughout the series, to be honest. It just wasn't successful in the first game. Now at this point we have the mid lane again, or the bot lane first of all being attacked, but the mid lane is also getting pushed by Korth and Luck, and it's just a reactionary game that is being played by VOX Nihili now. They're down a talent, it's very unlikely for them to win a fight at this point, so they're not trying to just like do anything too aggressive right now. They're just sitting tight, waiting for Murloc geniuses to make their move and make a mistake. 12 kills against 4, and still half a level away from level 13. But at the top lane, this is where we have a massive push, and these two heroes combined can push so hard. They're so strong when it comes to lane presence, but of course down to the bot lane we're having still a 4 versus 2, and that means that Sray and Ryx, you have to move away to make sure that they are not going to get taken out yet. But it's going to be a trade. The fort at the top lane is eventually going to fall. There is still Sylvanas, but Zagara moved back. Level 13 talents will hit soon. But this is Murloc geniuses moving through the wall at the keep. The shrines activate also. Another 30 seconds. Here's the potential kill. Stray on the run. Oh, and the Maw is saving his ass. Well played here. Great Maw and the root. But Stray is dead. No luck for Johanna. Never lucky. They're trying to move back now, the Murloc Genius, but they're sucking them in again with the Primal Grasp and the kill against Malfurion. The silence is too late. Sylvanas was a bit too late for this one. Great play here again by the Genius. 14 kills against 4 and a Dragon Knight on the map. The 13 talent is finally ready here for VOX Nihili, but well, good luck with that considering that the level 16 talent is going to hit any second now for the Murloc Geniuses. They are mad. The last game seemed to have really pissed them off. They are showcasing now how strong they are, and we have them with the Stone Form on Mirrodin. We're seeing them with Kerrigan going into the Blood for Blood, even the damage aura, the two-shot aura for good old Taranda, and of course also Stone Skin on Sonya. So a lot of survivability here. They can even stay in these fights longer than they already are. Tassadar is taking his sweet time claiming the shrine up at the top lane. Might be contested here, but down to the bot lane, Equinox is apparently waiting for another potential kill and somebody to move in. But Matt Timmy is the one who really has to be a bit careful here. They could have maybe taken that Dragonite if they would have been a bit faster, I suppose, but they're trying to go for straight sweet time in for him. And there's the stun, but this time he dodges. Gets the condemning, is sucked back in by Kerrigan and dies anyways. Sray is not having a good game here. I mean, he was killed six times. He's playing solo tank though. I mean, it's pretty obvious that as a solo tank you are going to be the one hero that is being hated on the most if you do well and position yourself between your teammates and the opponent. And right now it's like the third Dragonite. This time it's Korth and Lux time. Everybody is able to pick one up. Faye actually like got two, but they are going to the bot lane already. Top is, by the way, pushed by a camp on the side of VOX Nihili, but that's not going to do too much. But the bot lane, this is really where we're going to see the party happening right now. They want the keep and they want it now. They went through the wall earlier and now they want to just reap what they saw. They go in and take the first keep. They might even move through this. We are only 12 minutes in, so it's really early in the game still, but they could try to get a second keep. They're not moving for the core just now, and they don't really want it to backdoors too hard, so they just move out, move to the mid lane, and try to take the towers down first before they do anything else. Level 17 versus level 15 at this point, and yep, there's another big owl hitting as we speak. So level 13 talents did not really bring them the relief that they were hoping for. They're always down a talent. That's of course the most difficult position that you can be in Heroes of the Storm, and you play without being on even talents, or you have to fight, and this is what they wait for now. They play defensive. They're just trying to not lose another keep and then fight on 16 and win a team fight. If that doesn't work, then I think it's going to be lights out in the end for them. There's no potential for backdooring this time. There's no Zeratul. There's no Abathur. You can't move in like you did before. You can heavily rely on Sylvanas and Zagara. Get a Maw and maybe like a good Wailing Arrow. But at this point, it didn't really work for them just yet. So, let's see. We have Spell Shield on Johanna, in case that you didn't see that yet. A lot of defensive talents here. I mean, with the multi-shot build that Vala has been going through, we see her, of course, with the Frost Shot. on level 13. That gives her a bit more control in those team fights. But one of the most crucial points in this case is still that we're having defensive talents for most of them. Barb shot once again taken on level 1, in case you're wondering. And that combos off, of course, with the evasive fire. Cold Embrace, Blood for Blood, pretty much the standard, with the exception of the Holy Renewal here. So you get the additional heal here, and this is actually like very cool, because it's something that Sray really, really needs. Without those heals, he needs something to stay alive longer. He is really, again, the Stormbolt hits, there's the stun comp, he gets unstoppable, but he's getting taken down again. Oh my god. Like, they eliminate Sray, and now the chase is on. They really go for the kills now. Look at Koth and Luck just splattering Goku into the ground. Zagara is getting jumped. Equinox jumps through half the screen with his level 13 talent. His Eviscerate allows him to just go in from such a huge distance. It's a quad kill, and they might even get the fifth one. The silence is happening, but you know what? They don't even care anymore. They're like, yeah, well, Sylvanas, you can run, but you can't hide. We're going to take the core. We don't need to kill you. We're going to finish the game right now and force game number 3. Amazing play by the Murloc geniuses here. They also take down Sylvanas now, and this, of course, is it. A tie in the series, yet the grand final, well played, and GG, the Murloc geniuses are back to business. The final game, ladies and gentlemen, of the grand final at the end of the Storm North America. The second qualifier tournament, and we have our final map between the Murloc geniuses and VOX Nihili. Here on Sky Temple, to the left side, we have again VOX Nihili. They took the first game, lost the second. They play with Sray this time on ETC, Rixie on Tacita. We have Goku on Tyrael, the Goat on Tyrande, and Hosti on Zagara. To the right side of the map, Koth and Luck for the Murlocs on Sonya. Again, we have Matt, Timmy on Uther, Faye on Sylvanas, Fury on Mirrodin, and Equinox on Illidan. A very aggressive setup that we're currently seeing for the Murloc geniuses. And it kind of caters to the playstyle that they've been showcasing in most of these games already. Kerrigan got banned out this time, and they have a lot of stuns here and also aggression, and they are showcasing this already. Illidan jumping in very early for him to engage in these battles. Level 1, not really featuring the strongest Illidan of the game. But this is going to be extremely dangerous for VOX Nihili. They have very few stuns that they can actually use here. They have a Maw on Zagara, which doesn't really count too much, since you would sacrifice an entire heroic just to get the control. But in the fights, of course, you can try and section off a few heroes. The crazy part is really that they only rely on the stuns on ETC and Tyrande when it comes to controlling Illidan. And we have Illidan with Sonya gonna jump the backline, both of them, and the Vine Shield and Uther can keep them safe, and even the silence attempt by Faye here. Of course, what we're going to try and see, or what we're going to see as an attempt on the side of VOX Nihili, is the potential sanctification used with the Mosh Pit to keep ETC safe. It's basically like the same theory of using a Divine Shield at ETC into a Mosh Pit. But there is a bit of a lack of damage that we're currently seeing on the side of Team VOX Nihili. Even if they get a Mosh Pit through, they really have to coordinate their efforts well to get these kills in before the Mosh Pit duration is over. When it comes to the level 1 talents, we have once again a couple of like adjustments. Compared to the European scene, it's again that block that we see on Sonya. Normally we're having a shot of Fury taken or even Warpaint, depending on how exactly you play it here. That block, on the other hand, can of course keep you alive a bit longer in these scenarios. It's not really a bad talent at all. We saw that already coming into play in one of the earlier games. We have on Zagara now Corpse Feeder taken, so you can already tell that she really wants to make sure that they can push in, and that Corpse Feeder talent allows her to pretty much take a temple solo in the later stages. Tacita already down up at the top lane here. This aggression that we see, I mean, these heroes, Illidan jumping into the back line, Sonya always looking for a good Ancient Spear and then a kill. It's going to be very scary. Very, very scary indeed. I mean, right now, that one kill that we saw in the top lane, it's not going to be too important. It's not going to have like this big impact on the game yet. But this is still a very scary situation with the lineups that we're seeing in the game, in my opinion, for Team VOX Nihili. If they fall behind at any point in the game, a comeback, in my opinion, is going to be nearly impossible, since there's so much momentum building up for Murloc geniuses once they get ahead with that setup that they have here. It's very aggressive, and it just like it really feeds off that momentum that you can get. Interesting talents here once again, a few adjustments. There's a good kill, that's a good start into the game. That's exactly what they have to do. Well done here. VOX Nihili utilizing that stun combo with ETC and Taranda, and that has to be their play throughout the game. This is really strong right now, and they might get a few more than that. There's their stun! There it is! They get a kill against Muradin. Great effort here in the early game. That has to be their play in the early stages. Get a bit ahead of the opponent and then try to use just like that advantage to keep them low. So far, so good on the side of VOX Nihili. It's going to be a great game. And we're having also now more damage. Retribution with the cooldown on Smite being reduced, the extra damage against the heroes that we're seeing here. And Taranda not going for a damage build, but instead we have her on level 4 with the extra shield. Using this already. And as you can see, we have also on the side of the opponent's team now starting, well, the talent starting to tickle in. And this is going to be a fun one. ETC, by the way, went in this case for Proc Rock, so we have not the focus on the power slide, but instead trying to just like keep heroes alive a bit more. It's a great addition to what they already run with Tacita and also Taranda, even more sustained during fights, and they will need quite a bit of that. We have Kalas and Razor level 7, both of the teams hitting the next level at the same time. Matt Timmy, yeah, he really needed someone to help him out here. Koth and Luck, ooh, moves away, Sray already being attacked here. Both of the teams on level 7, as I said, a triple battle momentum has now been taken. Three battle momentums on Taranda, on Tyrael, and on Zagara. It's all about that cooldown reduction. Really everything that happens here, if you think about it, even Tyrael, I mean, he went for Retribution and for battle momentum. Talk about a reduced cooldown. Level 7, of course, Ferocious Healing for Sonya. Look at these kills! You can't be caught alone on the map if you want to survive against these bad boys. Down she goes, and that is, of course, now also a tower that's gonna fall. And I mean, the ideal, in an ideal world for them, they would be even able to do more damage and drop that wall. But Sylvanas is now being killed. Okay, kill for a kill, as we're seeing VOX Nihili moving in. They don't give an inch. Nobody here does. This is the third map. It's the final one. It's now or never. We have to take it now, or you are going to be the team that loses this grand final. And both of these teams are very, very eager to collect these points for the ranking. Already the jump on Fury. He saw Sray coming in and he was just like, yeah, screw that. Jump now or die. And he did it just in time. A second later, I'm pretty sure that power slide would have stunned him out. And then if Taranda is around, she can use that too. A bit of zoning up here at the top happening. Both of the teams want to go for that shrine, of course. Level 10s aren't there yet, but they start to fight for the temple down here. He has the stun against Faye, but she gets away with a quick haunting wave. And we have again that turnaround where we have Illidan moving in. Equinox, of course, does not have his metamorphosis just yet. Level 13 is one of the talents where he can be extremely strong, since he also has that sixth sense ability that helps him to even dodge more damage. These abilities I won't be able to do as much to him anymore. Again, the stun, this time against ETC, but so far VOX Nihili is doing pretty well here. Early on, they will have the upper hand, and they need to exploit that, and they're trying to. Level 10 will hit very, very soon for them. That's an extra talent, and that will win them the fight. That heroic ability, Sray is in, doesn't have the mosh pit yet. Yeah, he would have loved that. That would have been a great mosh pit for them. But they get the entire temple duration. They get the entire temple. The temple kills the fort. It's level 10 now. And we're seeing a maw. We're seeing also, in this case, now Starfall. Starfall and Stage Dive the talents on the side of ETC. There's no mosh pit in here. They don't go for the mosh pit. They go for Stage Dive as a global talent. And that's a really interesting touch to that. A Starfall to make, like, Starfall is great as, like, a zoning tool, also for damage and slow. And we have them, well, with a maw that they can use to, like, lead into the Starfall. But that Stage Dive is really interesting. I mean, that does, of course, a bit of damage, but I suppose that a mosh pit wouldn't have been too bad here. There's, of course, quite a few abilities that can cancel a mosh pit with a stun on Muradin. They can use the Wailing Arrow on the side of Sylvanas, to give only two examples. But still, we have now the Stage Dive as a tool that we didn't really expect, and let's see how that's going to come into play for them. Already the fight over the temple. Divine Shield super early on Illidan. Wow, that was the earliest Divine Shield that I've seen in a long time. And they're starting to jump in now with the Force Wall, cutting them off. Illidan is jumping around, uses Metamorphosis. Bro, we don't even have the Wailing Arrow yet. There was no commitment to the Wailing Arrow. This might be the chance that Faye has to silence all of them. But Mirrodin is jumping away. Faye still not using heroic ability. And Fury is about to die. Equinox is super low as well, but both of them are able to escape. Barely, but they are able to get away. Yeah, Faye very stingy with her Wailing Arrow there. She's like saying, well, not today, boys. I'm sorry, but like, you're not worth it. I like my ultimate off cooldown. Level 11 versus level 11 in this case now. And seeing the teams, of course, heading towards level 13. Up to the top lane, Faye's just like bursting these waves away thanks to the unstable poison on level 7. And very close still. I mean, we have 2 kills against 3 kills. The temples are being fought over again, or will be in another 4 seconds. Both of them are going for the Bruiser camp on their side. And it is a great match. We had a very, very cool first game. A very dominant performance in game number 2 by the Murloc Geniuses then to tie the series. And now they are on eye level. And I am loving it. This is fun. So right now, we have a very, very cool move with Faye already in the mid lane, trying to go for that. We have down to the bot lane the moves with Goku. Fury is there, Equinox. Goku has to jump away with the Druid's Mine, and he does, but he gets stunned out afterwards. And this is now finally, this is the sanctification that they needed. Maw also used. What a trap with a force wall! The silence hits, it's a kill, and maybe even a double kill. Yes, there we have it. The silence nearly able to save them. This time, Faye going straight for heroic, but it didn't really help. They lost 2 heroes, and now it looks like we're going to see a boss attempt on the side of VOX Nihili. These guys, they jump in, they have 10 seconds until Mirrodin and Uther are back, and they are doing solid work here. That sanctification really saved Tyrell, and then they turned it around, trapped everybody with the Maw, used also the Starfall, and had another quick force wall, making sure that nobody could escape. They take the boss. It's level 13 versus 13. There's still shots, by the way. Shots fired quite literally as Equinox is taking the temple in the mid. There's the 13 talents now for the two of them. Groupies have been chosen for ETC again. Equinox jumps in with the Metamorphosis. Here comes the stun on Tyrande. They're trying to move in. Again, the Sanctification being used by Tyrael, and they're moving away from it. We have even on the side of Uther now a Shrink Ray, which can help them with the control during the fights against a hero like ETC or Tyrael. Bot lane is now also pressured. That boss, of course, is still doing some work, is starting to go through the wall, but he's not going to be able to threaten that keep. ETC jumps in, but he doesn't hit anything with the stage dive here. Speed on Tyrande taken, imposing will, of course, prescience take, and there is the kill potentially. Yes, Illidan goes down. Illidan is dead. He's eliminated once again, and that is, of course, a slight lead once more for VOX Nihili. Great game. Great game so far. 6 kills against 2. VOX Nihili is able to maintain that lead. And I've been saying it earlier. If they fall behind, it's going to be incredibly difficult for them to come back. They need to stay ahead. They need to make sure that they are the ones in these fights to really call the shots. And so far, they've done exactly that. But it's not going to be easier in the later stages of the game. Once that they start to lose momentum in a fight, Illidan can just do his thing and can take them out. They are lacking control skills. They have a couple. They have a couple of stuns here. They have a few things that they can add. But they do not have enough to control all of these heroes. And it's extremely difficult for them to really go into these fights. But they have done an incredible job so far. 6 kills against 2. Very, very nice effort. Matt, Timmy and his boys, they have oftentimes, well, I think like a few times they were really a little bit early on their heroic abilities, but they're currently playing a great game here. So we currently see them in the mid lane. Oh, Mirrodin. Dude, like, you need to be careful. There's a lot of blue around you. 5 versus 5. VOX Nihili currently going up against one here in the mid lane, but Equinox could have jumped away with his Metamorphosis if need be. You don't really want to do that, of course. You don't want to use your heroic ability as an escape mechanism. At least not this early in a fight. But it's something that you can do if you are really in trouble. Ah, there's the stage dive again. Doesn't hit anything again, but Sray jumps in, and that was a good one. Here comes the Metamorphosis. Divine Shield has been used by Matt Timmy. Illidan might not have really needed it here, though. He already jumped away using his own ult. Now we have Sanctification being used, and again the Power Slide. They are pushing them back, and the Murlocs are retreating. One of the problems that the Murlocs really have in these fights is that they don't really coordinate their heroic abilities perfectly right now. They could use more momentum if they just waited a bit longer with that Divine Shield. Matini really wants to keep these guys alive, and he expects the burst against a hero like Illidan. Illidan more or less used his own heroic ability roughly at the same time, and therefore the cooldowns quite overlapped. We didn't really get too much out of it. Illidan was safe either way, but both of the cooldowns were activated, and that's a bit of a problem. If they can hold that a bit longer, then they can use it as a last mechanism, just coordinate a bit better, communicate there, and I feel they have a much better chance into these fights. In general, they did a great job here at disengaging, though. Like, ETC gave them a lot of trouble pushing them back here again. It's still a level 16 versus 16. They lost a lot of forts here, but this is still, like, a pretty sick game that we're seeing. We have Speed Metal taken. There's a Dimensional Warp, so Tassadar is going to be pretty safe for now. Of course, the Holy Ground, like the standard talent on Tyrion 16 these days. And on 16 for the opponents, we're having no Blood for Blood, but the Stone Skin, which is very popular these days. Once again, the fight already happening. These Force Vaults are great. Faye in trouble. Faye has a huge problem, but Divine Shield saves her. Great job by Matt Timmy. And here comes Illidan jumping in, but he is focused right away. Great Maw. I love how Vox Nihili is playing this right now. The silence is awesome. Equinox gets out of there somehow, but the rest of the team is in trouble. And Sonya drops, and now it might be also the end of Meridian. But he gets the stun and moves away. Everybody's mounting up, trying to chase. Matt Timmy on the run. He gets stunned, and he will die. He drops, Faye is escaping, and I am loving how Vox Nihili is currently able to control these fights. They are playing an amazing game. They really coordinate everything that they have just so well. ETC the entire time is able to get his power slides, and he hits so much for them. The zoning that we are seeing, the Holy Ground right now, the Maul that hit at the perfect time, giving that setup. But Hosty is the one who's suddenly in trouble as the rest jumps in. Very aggressive stance by the Murloc Geniuses, actually. Wow. With three heroes that are trying to go in against four. One was missing to get that kill, but they didn't. And they nearly lost Illidan in the process. So yeah, that was very aggressive what they were doing here. But it nearly worked out for them. It was close. Another thing that we, of course, have here now, too, is still like that mass cooldown reduction that we're seeing. The forts are destroyed, no keep has fallen yet, but with Fury in the mid lane, he's soaking all of the shots right now. It's actually interesting that Vox Nihili was just allowing them to take these last shots. They were in a pretty dominant position here. But now we have everybody moving around again, this time to the bot lane with Sray there. He can of course go to the off lane and jump in with the stage dive. Wow! That's balls to the walls! They go in for the boss and try to burst it down. But that was found out pretty soon, and everybody is fighting for the boss right now. Alright, we are in for a fun one. Here comes Equinox, he goes deep, Cawthon Luck does too. Metamorphosis again with the Divine Shield at the same time. Equinox is still healing himself here, uses also his shields, they jump in, and Vox Nihili is in a lot of trouble. Look at Tirana basically just getting away in the last second thanks to Sprint. Murloc Geniuses are going straight for Goku here. They might get that kill, but they're so low. Fury jumps out. It's a double kill as ETC falls, and so does Tyrael. And now they finally have a bit of momentum, but they lost Illidan. They're still going for another kill. They wanna have Tassadar, and it looks like he is not going to make it. Faye finds him where he is. There's the Force. Well, good luck with the escape. Nu are not gonna get away from this one, my friend. I'm sorry. Great moves here on the side of the Murloc Geniuses, even though that last Stormbolt misses as well. But that was a great fight for them. They're only slightly at an experience, though. It's still 5 kills against 9. It's an incredible game that we're seeing right now. Back and forth the entire time, and now finally that momentum starting to build up that you can execute with such an aggressive setup as the Murloc Geniuses are using. But, as I said it before and I say it again, Vox Nihili has done an incredible job in these fights, and they are not too far behind right now. They have to deal with the boss, which is a nuisance. There are temples on the map, and that's perfect timing, of course, for the Murloc Geniuses. But still, with another good battle where they have that sanctification, have also at the same time then a hostie with a really good Maw for zoning purposes, they can turn this around. They are playing a much, much better game here than I expected looking at these drafts. I really thought they would struggle a lot more keeping Illidan under control and the rest of the team, but they are doing a very, very nice job here. Tassadar with the shields, having the preload there all the time, making sure that Carla's embrace is really worth his efforts. And we have, of course, Goku with the shields that he can supply with material as well, using that sanctification on top of that. They are doing very good. But right now, we have the attack in the mid lane. Here comes ETC. They tried to go for Fury. And, yep, well done there with the escape. Keep in mind that Illidan is still at the top, and they are shooting at that keep in the mid lane and at the top lane. Not really threatening any of the main structures just yet, but that will happen eventually. Also, another camp at the bot lane that is going in. Both of the teams claiming one of the temples. Actually, right now, Fury is trying to soak the last few shots for his team, and he is going to get them. He gets the 5 last shots of the temple. Well done. And they have level 20 now, of course. And with the Storm Talons, we are seeing not only the Bulwark of Light, but we're having a double Hardened Shield and Demonic Form. Here come the 20s for their opponents, though. Storm Shield, Blink on the side of Zagara, Ball of the Storm for her. And let's see how VOX Nihili is going to play this. They have now the Crowd Pleaser. I am loving it. It is such an amazing talent. Crowd Pleaser, double Storm Shield, so much sustain. ETC is gonna hop around like a bunny in these fights if he does it right. And we're having so far Tyrael not with his 20 just yet. Tyrael is actually waiting a long time for his Storm Talent here. Did not take that yet. Battle Arena would be an option for him. He could go for the extra damage if they feel that they need that. It would be... There it is! We have the Holy Arena, my bad. But still, the extra damage on his Sanctification. And they are starting to jump in. Temple is still up to the top lane. Here comes ETC, the rest of them. Look at the Force Wall! Oh, Hosty! But Equinox is being controlled. In comes Tyrael and Illidan again. And here's the Crowd Pleaser. Jumps in, does the damage, and rushes right away after them. Going for Korth and Laku gets isolated by a Force Wall. They push him back, and Sonya is dead! The Maw is hitting too. Great job by Hosty, and they turn it around and try to drop them. Fury is low, Illidan is doing Illidan. What a silence! Oh my god! Faye might just have single-handedly turned that battle around. Silence used, another Crowd Pleaser here. Slay is jumping around, and they isolate Illidan from the rest of the team, especially Matt Timmy, who is now also going to fall. Great play here. No redemption on Uther. He went for the Bulwark of Light, and that is a triple kill. 1-4-3, great moves, and they are starting to cross the map. Up to the top, the shots are still there. They could do damage against the structures directly, and they already eliminated the keep in the mid lane. Up to the top lane, we also have a keep taken out, but this is a really fun match now. This is really good. I'm loving this. They want to go for core, and they might take it. They will. I mean, right now, what can happen? Is VOX Nihili really gonna take this with a 2-1, or are the geniuses coming back? The Murlocs, look at how low they all of a sudden are. But Faye is dead. Again, it is that Holy Arena that has been used, but they might not. Oh, here comes again Stray jumping in. He just jumps around the entire time, 90% on the core. He has 4 heroes alive, but already Tyrande is down. 2 heroes are up, Illidan is gonna come back. They won't be able to make it. They won't be able to kill the core. They won't be able to finish it. They won't win the game here. Goku dies. He can explode on the core. That's another 5% that he eliminates. In this case, actually only 4. And this is this the throw? Oh my god, IGN 6.5 out of 10. No comeback potential confirmed. Up to the top lane, Hosty is trying to gain a few shots, but there's too many minions. Even with his level 1 talent, the Corpse Feeder, he's struggling here. And now the Murloc genies are turning around. I can't believe what is happening here. This can't be happening. They actually go in. VOX Nihili, they look like the sure victor of this game, but now the Murloc geniuses are moving in. They're going straight for the kill against the core. It's a 5-3. They use the Divine Shield. Sonya alone with all the damage. What a final. What a game. Unbelievable. This is insane. Look at the attack. It's a base race. What the hell? 0-14. It is the Murloc geniuses that win the final of the End of the Storm North America with a 2-1.
And that is it, everybody. GG and well played. The game's over, and therefore also the video for today here on Khaldor TV. We had another great Heroes of the Storm match, and I hope that you enjoyed it. Also hope that you enjoyed the commentary, of course. So thank you very much for tuning in today. If you enjoyed the video, make sure that you give it a thumbs up on YouTube. And of course, if you haven't subscribed to Khaldor TV yet, you should definitely hit that sub button as well. If you have some friends that like Heroes of the Storm, then definitely make sure that you show them the channel and also the video. There's a lot more where that came from. We're going to have like continuous content throughout the next few weeks with more Heroes of the Storm matches played, not only on the European server, but also on the North American server, in tournaments, in leagues, and more than that. So guys, once again, thank you very much for tuning in today. I hope that you had some fun. It was a pleasure casting for you. And I'm going to see you next time with even more videos here on the channel. So have a great day and see you soon. Bye-bye.